Okay. All right. Hi, everyone. I'm just going to sing for a few minutes. I invite you to put down anything you might be holding, uncross your legs, your arms, and just even close your eyes and relax. A little bit of love from the sound world. Oh.
I forgot to mention, Claire, when you're
What?
done, we're going to just sit in silence for 2 minutes.
Oh, thank you. Gosh, I always forget to say that. Yes.
Yes. And then
Great.
so we'll
So.
just stay in silence. I'm going to go ahead and set it so people can't unmute themselves right now as well, just so that we know to do that and we're not interrupted.
Look at my crown chakra. So we good now? I can go?
Yes, go ahead.
All right.
Welcome, everyone. The Bioregional Regeneration Summit. Melina, Isabel, join me.
Yes, we're the three of us are your hosts and hostesses for this summit. And we're so excited to see you all here. We've been working on this for most of this year. It's been an idea that's just been growing in our minds. And we were so encouraged to get the response that we have been getting from all of you to say, yes, do it, it's important. So we've created a kind of chocolate cake of a summit. It has all sorts of deliciousness in it. And we hope you really enjoy it. You can dip into it and sample what you want. And we also really hope that you feel regenerated yourselves. We want to honor all of you who are here. And if you've been pioneering on your own for many years, and this importance of connecting is something we're going to come back to again and again. Welcome.
Well, I'm going to say something in English first, and I want to welcome everybody as well. I will be speaking in Spanish, and I have been trying to put everything in Spanish for all these in Spanish speakers. At this point, I would like to ask everybody to have this translation setting. So if you are English speaker only, please choose the English channel. If you speak Spanish, si hablas español, por favor, elige en tu interpretación el canal de español. If you are bilingual, you can stay on the original channel.
And the channels can be found at the bottom of the Zoom window where it says interpretation. There's a little globe symbol. You might have to click more to get to it. And great thanks to Andres for being our simultaneous translator.
Entonces, voy a hablar en español. Muchas gracias a todos. Muchas gracias por haber respondido a este llamado. Este es un intento muy profundo de escuchar a la Tierra, de escuchar lo que está pasando en el planeta y de empezar a generar espacios de participación profunda y colaborativa. Así que hemos hecho lo mejor que podemos para que realmente sea colaborativa. Por favor, participen y comprométanse porque vale mucho la pena estar juntos aquí. Hay mucho, mucho, mucho potencial. Muchas gracias por estar.
All right. So just a quick overview of what's going to be happening on this plenary. And I'm Ben Roberts, by the way, coming to you from Pagusset Land, now known as Newtown, Connecticut, one of the part of the core team, along with Melina and Isabel. We also have Lauren Minnis, who's doing some tech support in the background, but has been really instrumental in helping all of us to arrive here, and still helping people to arrive, I'm sure. So we're going to have a little opening ritual after this. A prayer of sorts that I'll talk about in a second. We'll welcome you to the summit a bit more in a bit more detail after that, talking about the context for the summit, our intentions. We'll get a little bit of input from you in the chat then. We'll go into small groups and let you just talk briefly with a few other people about what drew you here to the summit. Then we're really delighted to have two speakers, two keynotes with us in this plenary, John Fullerton and Daniel Christian Wahl. We'll be introducing them and hearing from them. We'll go back to small groups for a little bit so you can talk about what struck you from those conversations. And then we'll wrap up with some discussion on how to participate in the summit over the next 2 weeks. And we'll move straight from there into the first of our many hangout sessions. So I encourage you to stay around for another hour after the 90 minutes of this summit for that. And that's going to open up with more music from the fabulous Claire Hedin before we move into breakouts and just kind of connect and begin our process of mycelial interweaving with one another. So before I go to the ritual opening, though, I do want to say one more thing, which is, there's often traditionally a land acknowledgement that is done in in-person gatherings. But because we're virtual and we're all in different places, I want to acknowledge something else, which is the land, the lands and the people on those lands whose labor, whose toil, and often whose suffering goes into the creation of the electronic devices that we're using today. The precious minerals, the rare earths, the energy that runs all of this. Without that, we're not here gathering in this forum. And so I just want to acknowledge that we owe a debt of gratitude to them, and that we're in a sense, we're on a different kind of stolen land from the stolen land that I'm sitting on here in person. And speaking of stolen land, our ritual to open comes from the Haudenosaunee people, also known as the Iroquois, who have, as I understand it, given permission for this particular ritual to be performed by others. You know, it's something that what we don't always do. There's cultural appropriation is something, of course, to be concerned about. But in this case, as I understand it, these words, they're called the words that come before else, which are spoken in their gatherings at the very beginning of all gatherings. Our gift, they've been waiting 500 years, I've learned, for others to take up around the world. And so we've adapted this a bit from the website Dance for All People, where it's translated in one version into English. And we're going to do it as a collective ritual, because that's how this process is meant to be done. It's not that one person, like a priest, would say this, but that people in the circle would each speak up and offer their thanks for particular gifts that we've received that allow us to be here. And so what I want to do is invite anyone who feels called to, and there are a lot of us here, so we may have a little bit of overlap and you'll just have to decide, but you should be able to come off mute now. And maybe we'll have Isabel do the first one, and then we'll open it up to others. We've adapted this. There are a lot of these bits of thanks, so I'll show us the first one here. So someone's going to come off mute and read the text, and then when they've finished, we all come off mute and say, now our minds are one. In the final one of these, there'll be a pause before we do that. So we can just follow along with the slides. You should be able to use the split screen view so that you can also see who's talking. And let's go ahead. Isabel, can you lead us off, please, with this ritual?
We are all thankful to our mother, the earth, for she gives us all that we need for life. She supports our feet as we walk about upon her. It gives us joy that she continues to care for us as she has from the beginning of time. To our mother, we send our greetings and our thanks.
Now our minds are one. We give thanks to all the waters of the world for quenching our thirst and providing us with strength. Water is life. We know its power in many forms: waterfalls and rain, mists and streams, rivers and oceans. With one mind, we send our greetings and our thanks to the spirit of water. Now, our minds are one.
Now we turn toward nature, as far as the eye can see. The plants grow, working many wonders, They sustain many life forms and offer us food and medicine. Animals have many things to teach and to give us as people. We are glad they are still here, and we pray that this will always be so. With one mind, we send our greetings and our thanks to all of nature. Now, our minds are one.
We now send our greetings and our thanks to our Father, the Son. Each day without fail, he travels the sky from east to west, bringing the light of a new day. He is the source of all the fires of life. With one mind, we send our greetings and our thanks to our Father, the Son.
Now we turn ourselves to the Great Spirit and send our greetings and our thanks for all the gifts of creation. Everything we need to live a good life is here on this Mother Earth. For all the love that is around us, we gather our beings together as one and send our choicest words of greetings and thanks to the Great Spirit.
Our minds are one.
We have now arrived at the place where we end our words. Of all the things we have named, it is not our intention to leave anything out. If something has been forgotten, we leave it to each individual to send their greetings and their thanks in their own way. Now our minds are one. Dear everyone. Isabel, over to you to continue our welcome with some context setting, and then we'll hear from Melina about intentions.
Yeah, so I'm going to set the context for what we are all doing together here. And I'm going to set a deep time context and a big geosystemic context, and then come back in to thinking about the work that we're all doing in our separate places. So bioregions are a way of human organizing that we have been practicing for at least 500,000 years, if not more. And certainly Neanderthals lived in bioregions and gathered food and water and shelter and so on in bioregions. And it's a practice of being on the earth that many indigenous peoples still experience today. But those of us living in the global north have lost connection with. So it's very exciting that at this time of global stress, when geosystems, and sometimes I talk about Gaia being on the move, we know that geosystems are reaching tipping points because of climate change, that we have ice caps melting, we have the Atlantic meridional overturning circulation, faltering, it's the Gulf Stream. We have all sorts of other issues to do with geosystems being destabilized. The question is, how do we respond? So going back to how humans have always lived on the earth, for many of us seems like a very intuitive and regenerative thing to do. And so the fact that we're all together here, exploring what this means to us in multiple different ways, because we're all bringing different ideas and experiences to the table, is a moment of great hope and richness and strength. And we really hope that during the summit, we'll all be able to experience that together. But I also want to bring into this space the shoulders on which we stand, and many, many nameless people, of course, but the people I want to name, Peter Berg and Kirkpatrick Sale, who from the 1960s onwards in the Pacific Northwest of the USA pioneered the whole idea of bioregioning and its practice. And I also want to name Donella Meadows, who in 1980 produced a paper which has been largely unrecognized and unpublished about bioregional learning centers, which is on, in fact, on the Bioregional Learning Center website if you want to access it. And I also want to acknowledge Elena Ostrom, who for many of us was such an inspiration in getting us to think about common pool resources and our responsibility to steward them fairly. And so in that context, we are bringing many different pieces to the table, many different experiences, ways of thinking, ways of organizing. And during the summit, we're going to be exploring how we put those pieces together and how we make this work on the ground. So it's not just a think exercise. We want to make this work in many different places. And we look to the pioneers before us to help us see the way. And as we've already talked about, this is all about collaboration, because bioregioning is a relational practice. And I'm going to hand over to Melina now to say more about that.
Gracias, Isabel. Lo primero que quiero decir, y porque estoy a cargo de la traducción en español, es que por favor todas las personas que hablan español pongan una ES al principio de su nombre, donde en las opciones que tienen en participantes, escogen su nombre y ponen renombrarse, para que podamos ponerlas con personas que hablan español cuando hagamos los grupos. Entonces, gracias Isabel por hacer, por introducirnos a esto, porque realmente lo que estamos haciendo aquí es recordar cómo ser naturaleza. La regeneración nos invita a poner la vida en el centro porque es un proceso natural, primero. Segundo, la escala de acción a la cual ya todos resonamos y sabemos que tenemos que actuar es a través de la biorregión, porque tiene sus límites sociales, culturales y biológicos, ecológicos. Y lo que nos une y la resonancia que nos permite ahora estar aquí juntos es la colaboración radical. Y radical en el sentido de raíz, en el sentido de conexión con los territorios, en el sentido de enraizarnos en la tierra y también en el sentido de claridad frente a qué es lo que debemos hacer y ponernos en un modo de colaboración real. Este espacio que hemos hecho es un espacio participativo en donde queremos abrir los flujos de información para hacer intercambios de muchas maneras que nos permitan autoorganizarnos. Esos intercambios deben darse en conexiones que hacemos entre personas, entre biorregiones y entre redes de alcance biorregional. La Red Global de Comunidades Regenerativas ha hecho este encuentro con la conciencia plena de que no buscamos ser la red de redes, de que es imposible hacer una red de redes porque la red de redes es el planeta mismo. Entonces, lo que estamos tratando de hacer es responder a las necesidades que hemos escuchado. Hemos escuchado las necesidades de las redes para financiar su trabajo biorregional. Hemos escuchado a las biorregiones la necesidad de nutrirse de otras biorregiones y aprender de las habilidades que muchas biorregiones han adquirido con su trabajo. Y hemos también escuchado las necesidades de los financiadores que no encuentran canales claros para financiar trabajo biorregional, pero que también tienen dificultades en tener una coherencia entre las expectativas de inversión y el trabajo biorregional como tal y la regeneración territorial. Entonces estamos abriendo este espacio para juntos permitir la emergencia de algo nuevo y muy poderoso que nos lleve a hacer una colaboración radical y autoorganizarnos en algo nuevo que pase. Ese es el potencial que tenemos aquí y esta es la intención para este summit. Entonces, Ben, si quieres guiarnos con el siguiente paso. Gracias.
So I was going to offer a little bit of a preview of what's going to happen over the course of the summit. But I'm not going to do that because we're running a little bit behind schedule. And we do want to finish mostly on time and move into the hangout. We know some of you might have to leave after the 90 minutes. I will be speaking at the end about giving you a little bit of a sort of a tour of the platforms and the tools, but maybe a little air of mystery doesn't always hurt. What I want to do though then is move us into two participatory processes. So the first we call a chatterfall, and so I want you to invite you all to put into the chat an answer to this question, but don't hit enter until you're until we say so. So we're going to see all these at once. So what drew you here is what we're looking for you to answer in English, or you can write it in Spanish, that's fine. And after a minute, I'll invite you to put that into the chat and we'll take a look at what's there. And then the other thing is I just want to emphasize again, I'm going to be creating breakout groups because after this we'll go into small groups to continue talking about this question, what drew you here? And I need all the Spanish speakers to put an ES in front of their name by renaming themselves, as Melina asked you, so that I can group you with your fellow hispanoparlantes. So thank you. Let's just sit for a moment. I'll play just a little bit of music while we go ahead and answer this question in the chat. Go ahead and hit enter if you haven't already done that. Take a look at what's there. Thank you. All right, I've got breakouts set up. We're going to go into them for 10 minutes, and you can continue the conversation about what drew you here. Make sure you share the airtime. There are four of you, a couple rooms, there are five. I'm going to actually turn on the option to choose your room, so you'll go straight into a room, but if for some reason there isn't somebody there, or you are an Hispanoparlante and you haven't put the ES in front, you can look for other people with an ES and move around, and I'll be here in the main room too. So it may be a little messy, it may be a little wild, but if you're by yourself or you're not speaking the language, you can go ahead and move, and I think we're ready to go. We'll see you back here in the main room in 10 minutes. When the 1 minute warning comes, use that time to stay in your room. Don't click leave your room, just use that extra time. So here we go. Welcome back, everyone. Welcome back. Looks like we're not all quite here yet. Should be back now. So Andres, our simultaneous translator, has told me that sometimes this settings get disrupted when you go in and out of a breakout. So again, you want to go to the bottom of your Zoom window if you want Spanish translation, or if you want Spanish translated into English, go to the bottom of your Zoom window, look for the interpretation symbol. It's like a globe. You might have to click more to get to it. And then once you click that, you'll see the option to hear the simultaneous translation in English or in Spanish. Or you can just not turn that on if you're bilingual, if you're bilingual.
Good.
Okay. Oh, Vetcher's got it. All right, great. Yes, so people have reset it. And I think we're ready to turn it over. Yes, we hear you in English.
No, I am hearing the translation in Spanish.
The interpreter coming in on the English channel. All right, so I think we are ready to move on. I'm going to turn it over now to
William.
You're turning it over to me, Ben, and I'm very happy to be here to introduce John Fullerton, who's going to give us a short talk about his personal journey into bioregions and bioregioning. In our breakout room just now, we've been talking about paradigm shifts and seeing things differently and having the courage to think big at system scale, to learn from indigenous peoples about how they connect to the world, and to be braver about creating a new language and walking our talk. And that's something that John really has done and is very inspiring in the way that he does that in the world of global finance. So for many of you, John won't need an introduction. He founded the Capital Institute in 2010. Before that, he worked on Wall Street for JP Morgan. So he was fully immersed in the financial system. He knows it extremely well. But in 2001, he, as some people might say, he was gyred. He saw things differently. He decided to walk out and to walk into a braver way of being, challenging the system from within. And John continues to do that. He's the author of Regenerative Capitalism, How Universal Patterns and Principles Will Shape the New Economy. He's also leading a very excellent course in regenerative leadership right now. And his piece that he brings to the table is about finance. But of course, it's not just about that. He's a very thoughtful, philosophical person. And I really want to honor that he, together with Stuart Cowan and Edward Muller, co-founded Regenerative Communities Network, I think it was back in 2018, when I first met John in 2019 in Mexico. But John, I want to turn it over to you now to tell us a bit about your journey towards bioregions and bioregioning. John, you're muted.
Yeah, there we go.
There you go.
Thank you, Isabel, and greetings to everyone. It's really exciting to see this happening and to be with you all here today. There's obviously a lot of irony, to say the least, about a Wall Street guy showing up and having a place in a conversation like this. And the truth is that I'm actually more working around economic system design than the financial system. The financial system is, in my opinion, the largest obstacle to the emergence of bioregional regenerative economies, cultures. And the work on the financial system really hasn't even begun yet, to be very candid. It's probably the hardest nut to crack. But what I wanted to share today with you, just very briefly, you know, I'm now living in Eastern Connecticut, what is formerly Pequot Nation. And my journey into this work has been just a series of unbelievable synchronicities. And one of the synchronicities of me moving here to a place that I discovered when I was literally in my 20s. So it's sort of a returning to this place that called me. After we moved here, I learned that the original genocide in North America was the Mystic Massacre, which occurred just down the street from where I live. And so I've been called back to the ground zero of the destruction of the wisdom that we actually need at this time, as we all know. And so it gives me chills actually to think about the distance. I can almost see Wall Street from here, but it's a world away. And my journey to this work really, you know, it began, I wrote a paper called The Relevance of Schumacher in the 21st Century in 2008, which was kind of my coming out of the closet document, like first time I went public with my thoughts that were still not very well formed. And interesting as Belle, you mentioned Patrick Sale, he was very close with Schumacher, and I learned about his work at the Schumacher Center. And but I hadn't, the idea of bioregionalism didn't click yet. That work was kind of local, but I didn't have a context for that. And that paper was sent to a man in Zimbabwe named Alan Savory. And I got an email out of the blue one day from Alan Savory, who was working on what's essentially biomimicry at landscape scale, grasslands landscape scale. And he saw some, you know, Wall Street guy who seemed to get some of this stuff. And so we formed a friendship and then a partnership. And I learned about what he calls holistic plant grazing through experiential learning on the ground. I actually invested in a company with them. And so I know this works at the landscape scale of the grasslands. I've seen it with my own eyes. I've seen the numbers. And it occurred to me that if this works on this system called the grasslands, why couldn't it work on the system we call an economy? And so that was really my journey into this work. And of course, we've organized our world by countries and by corporations. And so we're in conflict with the truth of bioregional reality. And that tension is something that all of you that have been working in this bioregional work far longer than I have feel, I know, every day. And probably the tension of capital, money, is at the heart of that tension. It's the big elephant in the room. And the exponential function embedded in finance is in many ways for me the root of all of these interconnected crises that we're now experiencing. But at any rate, that experience with Alan Savory led to this idea. They have a group of place-based hubs where they do training. And so, as you mentioned, Stuart Cowan and I got together and started imagining, could we create a network of bioregional placed initiatives to help us all learn from each other? And I have an expression I like, I don't know if you guys will like it or not, but I say that there's that every snowflake is unique. So every bioregion is unique geologically and culturally, but every snowflake also looks like a snowflake. And I do believe that there are common patterns and principles, living systems principles, that while unique in each context, are shared across all living contexts. And if we could learn to see the world through that lens, we would be on our way to finding solutions. So I just want to close by sort of honoring the work that you're all doing. I intellectually understand how hard it is, but many of you are working in this tension where the power sits in governments and in corporations, and the future is in bioregions. And my word of hope is that the worse things get, the more that will become apparent to people. And I already sense that happening, even inside large corporations and eventually the power structures of finance as well. Thank you.
Thank you, John. Thank you for bringing that understanding from that perspective. Muchísimas gracias. Ahora voy a presentar a Daniel Cristian Wahl, que está con nosotros. También él es un catalizador de este proceso de regeneración y ha trabajado en muchos aspectos, ha escrito mucho, tiene un blog increíble, tiene un libro que se llama Diseñando Culturas Regenerativas y está enfocándose en este trabajo de regeneración biorregional también en la isla donde vive, en Mallorca. Ha trabajado desde la perspectiva del diseño para la salud humana y planetaria, ¿no? Y pues está desde la perspectiva de los sistemas vivos, es biólogo, y tratando de traer esta visión holística, esta visión sistémica a lo que hemos visto ahora. Entonces queremos invitar a Daniel a que nos ayude también desde desde tu perspectiva ahora, como cuáles son este proceso de regeneración biorregional y cómo inspíranos. Gracias.
Well, gracias, Melina. Thank you so much for inviting me. And just as John just said, funny that the Wall Street guy is talking here, or finance guy, in a similar way, I feel like, yeah, another white guy with a PhD talking at the opening of a panel. But I'm so glad that, of a summit, but I'm so glad that what Melina and Isabel already mentioned, Isabel mentioned that as we speak about bioregional regeneration, we're not speaking about some kind of utopia that we want to dream up and create in the future, like all the future visioning blue sky processes of solutioneering in the sustainability field have done. No, we're actually trying to remind ourselves as the human family that our evolutionary pattern has been to be bioregional custodians at the ecosystem scale, at the scale of the regions that we didn't only inhabit, but that we understood ourselves to be living expressions of. And so for me, it's really important in this opening to make that link that rather than going into, shouldn't we all be like the indigenous versus non-indigenous and all of that, to actually find ourselves, and I've had many conversations with indigenous leaders around this, to find ourselves on that higher ground of being indigenous to life and understanding the impulse that is now happening all over the globe, otherwise we wouldn't be here, of bioregional regeneration popping up everywhere as part of life's own regenerative impulse moving through us. And what we can best do is to try to be apprentices in how to do this more collaboratively. Like the invitation of this conference is what opportunities are emerging from radical collaboration in support of bioregional regeneration. For me, this speaks at the international level to us to be invited to be radically collaborating rather than othering each other, even in this summit, to find ways where if we get triggered by, oh, he mentioned finance, I get triggered, or another white guy, I get triggered, to catch ourselves in these triggers, because that's the divide and conquer that is trying to stop us from doing what we are now called to do, which is let life flow through us in a positive, life-supporting way. That is not about well, we shouldn't have another white guy. Yes, we should have much more racial diversity on this call, but we're trying to build this bridge with the people here. So let's not have a disruptive argument over the summit, but Ben and Isabel and Melina have created a wonderful opportunity for us to co-create the summit. And I'm so glad that in the opening talks, everybody else, it was already mentioned, like I first got into bioregionalism in 2001 at Schumacher College, another Schumacher reference. And yes, I was also reading Peter Berg, Planet Drum Foundation, and Human Scale by Kirkpatrick Sale. But I maybe want to mention another person, Thomas Berry, in The Dream of the Earth, speaking about bioregionalism, really touched me 20 years ago. And I've been on that journey since then. In that master's at Schumacher College, I wrote my master's on exploring participation from a kind of complexity and holistic science understanding. And even then, I realized that the missing scale and how to fit human patterns of dwelling, of inhabitation, back into a living planet, a living biosphere, life as a planetary process, is at the scale of the region, and that the local by itself is not enough. And that we need to do so in a way that is scale linking, that recognizes that while we can only meaningfully reduce all this complexity out there through becoming specific to place and people, to a bioregion, because if we go into abstractions and we try global solutions that we then implement no matter what the place and the people, we have the COP20 whatever process. So what we need to do is to dive into the specifics of the region. But for me, this is also one of the things we should maybe discuss this week or in over the next 2 weeks, is how do we collaborate radically bioregion to bioregion and learn collectively, but how do we at the same time not tap energy from the process we're actually called to do, which is to meet real people in real places in the bioregions we inhabit and do the really difficult work of radically collaborating with them. Because one of the things that comes in when we don't do intentional community eco-village work, which I've dedicated 15 years of my life to, which is conveniently trying to reduce complexity by saying, oh, I'll just find like-minded people and create a little village with them, is that at the bioregional scale, all the people are on the table, around the table. We need to talk to the people who have a radically different opinion, and we need to find it within us to see the diversity within our regions as a richness, even if we fundamentally disagree with people because they're on the other side of the political spectrum or because of whatever worldview they're holding. It's really this reminding all of us that we are indigenous to life and that life is fundamentally a regenerative process that if we get out of the way can flow through us. And yeah, what do you think about that, John? I'll leave it at that because I think we're running behind time and I'd love to have a conversation.
1 second to bring John back to the spotlight with you. Go ahead.
You okay? Great. Well, what do I think about that? I love that, as you know, Daniel, and I also want to point out, I love the visual behind you, a map of watersheds, which is a good close proxy really for what the world might look like if we organized around bioregions or watersheds. Where shall I start? I mean, I'm curious how you are holding the reality that as much as everything you just said is your truth and feels right, the resources of the world, meaning money in this moment, are organized and structured in nation states and multinational corporations. And the resources need to be recycled, reconfigured into alignment with this bioregional idea. And how do you deal with that in your daily reality? If that's a question.
Yeah, and it's a very tricky one because it is this kind of bringing the emperor's tools onto deconstructing the empire. Exactly. And And that's a tricky one. And it's riding a paradox, and it's a work of constantly checking in with integrity through all the senses, not just the thinking mind, but intuition, sensing, and feeling, whether the other person who is trying to have this conversation is coming from integrity. And I know, for example, that you are coming from integrity with what you're trying to do to build this bridge. And I see large corporations jumping on the regenerative agriculture meme and the finance flows that support that kind of global food system that is supposed to be regenerative. I'm questioning. I can't. And there might even be for those players a need to engage with them in a transition, but only if they're willing to fundamentally transform themselves. And maybe the one thing that I noticed regarding finance and philanthropic finance is that the problem is that in the move towards trying to be efficient with the money that is being donated, people tend to fund large established projects because they feel like they're less likely to waste their money on them. Mm-hmm. And because funding a few large projects is less admin than funding hundreds of tiny localized projects. Mm-hmm. And I personally think that it should be the other way around. And that's why, that if you're also interested in this, there's a website called regenerosity.world that is now housed within the Buckminster Fuller Institute, but it's specifically trying to address this, giving large foundations the option of giving to this platform so it can then be divvied out to smaller projects. And of course, we need also massive finance to shift the larger systems, but it's exactly there where I'm getting a bit worried, because if we build large new green deal pipe dreams for the top 10 or 5% of the planet, we might just squander the last resources we have to build the bioregional resilience into the system. Right. To cope with the collapses that are now coming hard and fast, and that, yeah, we can't avoid anymore.
And in that case, the resources, not even the money resources, the kind of, call it the ecological footprint capacity resources that are being squandered on initiatives. And the other thing that I just want to say is that the philanthropic world is also trapped in a kind of, you know, define a project, measure success. The biggest success of a lot of these regenerative place-based initiatives is simply the relationship building connection, the weaving that happens. And it's not the original intent of the project to fix a dam or fix a river or whatever the fix thing is. It's that it, you know, and as Isabel's work so beautifully shows us, it's the actual connection of people that live in a bioregion that haven't had reason to connect with each other. And that creates the potential for regenerative potential, which no one knows in advance, because that's why it's called potential and hasn't yet manifested.
See, this is an important bit. Like, it, as we, and I think this is the key of how to include the diversity at the real face-to-face bioregional scale when we're working not in international collaboration, but in real local regional projects, is that, as somebody, was it Isabella or Melina, said beautifully, bioregioning is a relational practice. And it's in this engaging at the local scale that we can begin to build a new field of working differently together, rather than come together to work together in the same old ways. And that's the big, like, we as we move into uncertainty together in times where the one thing we know for certain is that systems will collapse around us and we will have to build alternative systems or new systems at local and regional scale, we need to really step collectively into the unknown, and that means holding solutions more lightly. Even the well-meant technological solutions that well-meaning people are trying to put on the table. Because if we don't hold all the options in the space, we might just rush ahead with finance being more prone to finance those techie solutions and end up, like, I encourage everybody to just Google Olivia Lazard TED Talks the blind spot of the green energy transition. It's 18 minutes on why a techie solution out of this is impossible, and how to wisely use the resources and the money we've got and the very short window of opportunity to build the structured scale linking resilience into the system that we can meet uncertainty, which includes climate chaos, with a higher likelihood of human culture as an expression of life rebounding from what's coming. And that's what all these wonderful initiatives that we will hear in about in the summit, where people are working, whether it's in Colombia or in Costa Rica or in Maine or all over the world, on in Devon, on bringing people together. And it's ultimately the capacity for people to meet each other, to hold diversity, to say, and what next when things happen, that we're trying to foster? Because there isn't, we don't know the solutions yet. We just know what systems would be more resilient and more able to respond to uncertainty than the brittle system that we've got right now. And I'm worried
Do we have a little more time?
I hope so.
Okay. I'll keep going until I'm told to shut up. How's that? You're
4 minutes.
Okay, good. Plenty of time. You're sharing the reality of what's coming, and probably most, if not all, folks on this call share that what's coming dread. And I certainly do. And I kind of go from being pretty beat up and down about it to being able to hold it with some courage. And it reminds me, I just for the young people here, to share a short story about my dad that I think I shared when we first met in Mexico. But as difficult as this situation is, when my dad was near the end of his life, and he was in the Greatest Generation, fought in World War II, he was actually in the Navy on a ship off the beaches of Normandy. And toward the end of his life, I went on a trip with him and I asked him to talk about his life. And what was fascinating is he kept coming back to the war. And so it was clear to me that the war, as horrible and challenging and difficult as it was, gave purpose to his life. And as I think about our future that we're heading into, and in many places are in already, if you live in Pakistan right now, you're in it. And many other places. It's very comforting to know that the difficulties created meaning and purpose for that generation. And as I think about my own kids heading into this, that's the piece that I hold on to. And I don't really buy that we only have 5 years or 10 years, right? We're already decades late. So the point is that we're going through something and we're already on our way through it. And it's going to be the rest of our lives. And none of us knows what it's going to be. And it's going to be horrible for some people, but I don't believe it's the end of life as we know it. And so our challenge is to embrace that with the courage that our forefathers have when we've been faced with these situations before. And I'm not saying this because this is a bioregional summit. I have no doubt that as the pressures rise, more and more people will move to and engage in the bioregional work and build that community and those relationships that will be the repurposing of that energy. The back of the adaptive cycle, the release of energy will come back and in a more sane way, but it won't be going back to an indigenous way of living. It will be going forward into a corrected way of living, sort of a correcting for the error of the reductionist modern age. Despite all of its great advances, it's not in alignment with how life actually works. And so I think there's a way to remain hopeful. And I do believe that this bioregional idea, coupled with the living systems life's principles, is is sort of the self-evident North Star. And I can say I last week I was at a a big corporate sustainability thing, the regenerative brands, the sustainable brands conference. And I usually don't go to these things. And the organizer, Coann, pretty much made me come. And the reason is she said, John, don't confuse the companies with the people who are in our community. And they are hungry for this message and they need to hear you. It's true. And my message was really well received. And I think things are shifting. And I'm not talking about the Walmart that puts they claim they're going to become a regenerative company. It was startling. I'll just share one tidbit. No one's going to believe what I'm about to say.
We do need to wrap though, John, quickly. So
okay, then you don't get to hear what I'm about to say.
Well, we'll maybe come back and we'll hear that some other time. Right. I know you've got the Planeteers event as well that you'll be attending, right?
There's all kinds of things. But truth and reconciliation is the point. And I believe our challenge with the establishment companies and nation states is a truth and reconciliation process around what's going wrong with our economic system.
Can I follow for 30 seconds, Ben? Yeah, because I see that wonderful mycelial network behind you, and John spoke to life's principles. What I feel this mycelium metaphor is teaching us, that many of you might have seen these images of what a forest looks like if you dissolve all the cellulose away and you just see the mycelial shadow that pervades every branch and every trunk of the entire forest. And I think what you just said, John, is the invitation that we find these individuals in these places that the system wants us to other and have entrenched arguments about. And instead of othering them as individuals, we call out with integrity the institutions they're standing in and saying, this is not okay. But we talk to the individuals, and through that, we connect the mycelial network. And that is re-energizing this conversation of bioregional regeneration that includes everybody and doesn't other. So thank you.
I'll just piggyback on that. Mycelium not only connects the forest and the wood wide web, but fungi also can be ways to interpenetrate and act as parasites. So we can infect institutions and transform and transmute them as well with our mycelial powers, and find allies among the human beings within those institutions in that process, because they're part of that connection. But doing it in a way that doesn't blame, that doesn't other, I think is critical. And I hope that's some of the energy that carries forth in the summit. Thank you so much to both of you for getting us started with these provocations. So appreciated. Daniel, grateful that you'll be with us for more of the summit. John, I know you've got the in-person event in Portugal. I know I need to get you a slide to promote the summit for that, so look for that. We're going to move into breakouts now, and give you a chance to talk about what struck you about what you just heard. So again, if you are a Spanish speaker, hopefully you've put ES in front of your name and I've sorted you that way, but I've set it up so that you can move yourself around among the breakouts if you know how to do that. At the bottom of the Zoom window, there's a little breakouts thing that will show up once I open the rooms. So you can look for the other folks that have the ES if you need to, or if somehow people have left your room and you're all by yourself, you can move as well. So we'll do this for another 10 minutes. And then we'll come back and talk about how to participate in the summit and then move right into our first hour-long hangout space. I'm probably running a little long on this whole thing because it's already 10:20. So we're going to go an extra 10 minutes on the how to participate. If you miss it, it's all recorded. And we're here for all the hangouts to help you get oriented to all the aspects of the summit as well. So let's use the final 10 minutes of our scheduled time in the plenary to have this little breakout again and give you all a chance to connect with each other. We'll see you back here in 10 minutes. I'm going to open the rooms now. Feast. Yes. of different things that, is that going to the cloud? Yes, great. All kinds of things awaiting you that I was going to describe, and I was going to give you a little tour of the technology too. But I'm feeling like, you know, we're in the conversation, we're in the space right now. And so my I'm going to trust that with all the complexity of what we're offering here, that's a fractal and just not even close to the complexity of the global clusterfuck that we're trying to untangle and move beyond, that we're just going to find our way. And, you know, part of radical collaboration, I think, this call that we're making, is that we just kind of get over the fact that a lot of this stuff is hard and it's messy and it isn't always clear, and we're trying to navigate new territory and new tools and new technology and ancient ways that we've forgotten or that some people can still teach us and all of that. And so with that, I want to bring Claire back and move us into the first of our hangouts. Claire's going to drop us in for, I don't know, 7, 8, 9 minutes into a space of reflection with her powerful voice. And while that happens, I'm going to encourage you to connect in the chat a little bit if you want, but also to go to the network map and look at the map, look at who's here and look at the map. And if you know how to do this, I will put the link into the chat for it. So you can look at the participants list and you can look in the map. Maybe I'll just show you this one thing before we go to Claire. Since the map is one of my favorites, I'll put the link in here. And you can get to this inside of the, oh, I just sent that to Melina. let's try it going to everybody. Those of you, did I send it to Melina a second time? All right, I'm not going to put the link in the chat right now. Somebody else, Melina or Isabel, can put the link in the chat to the map. I'm going to share my screen though, and I'm going to show it to you briefly so you can see what I'm talking about. Just do a little bit of what I was going to do. So we're looking here at the Kiko chat interface. I've got the calendar tab open, but you can also go to the networking map here. And some of these things are a little squeezed into the embeds. You can go down to the bottom and pop them open into a new window. But for what we're doing now, actually, this is enough. You just go to the search button, right? So find a name of somebody here in the participants list. I don't have it. Okay, Amanda Kilroy. I see her listed there. So there she is. So you just start putting a name in and you click. And here's Amanda's profile. So instead of going around and introducing ourselves, you can just look at this and just, you can browse the larger map too. You can close that window with the tabs. Maybe you see a picture you like. You don't have to do this if you don't want to. You can just go in the chat or just take in Claire's music. But when Claire's done, I'm gonna just open a bunch of breakout rooms. And maybe some of you will have found each other here. And in the chat, you said, hey, I wanna be in a breakout room with you. We're gonna go back into those. You'll be able to move yourself around and you can stay here in the main room too. And I'll continue an orientation to the summit and all the different tools.
So Ben, before we go to there, yeah. I would like to present the video. It's like a 2 minutes video.
Oh yes, of course we have to do that, don't we? Yes, we do.
Yeah.
We're on what Bio Kamalafe and others, I was in a webinar with him this week and he kept saying, you know, we're on African time, which meant we're going over the allotted times in the calendar. So please, Melina, yes.
Yeah, thanks. So we have been talking about how to do radical collaboration and how to get into this knowledge of nature. So I prepared this video and I will just pass through it, talking about it en español. Vamos a ver la naturaleza y específicamente el moho mucilaginoso. es un moho ameboide que va por el suelo del bosque y que en un momento dado empieza este proceso de autoorganización increíble en el que se convierte en otra cosa, se convierte en esporangios para producir esporas que van a reproducir el hongo en otros lugares del bosque. Lo increíble es que son individuos, son células individuales que en un momento dado empiezan a volverse un colectivo y a seguir un proceso de señales donde ellos escuchan una señal, resuenan con ella y se mueven hacia donde se da esta señal. Y esta señal tiene un ritmo, tiene un pulso, tiene una posibilidad de comunicarse de tal manera que genera un flujo y un proceso de emergencia de un orden a una escala distinta. Esta escala distinta es como los procesos de redes que queremos hacer colaborativas a través de la colaboración radical, y son redes que pueden fusionarse unas con otras o que pueden estar en un proceso de encontrar sus espacios, sus locaciones, y funcionan a través de afinidades. Entonces hay abridores de caminos que pueden estar liderando un proceso u otro. El código que les queremos proponer es activar la metamorfosis presencial colaborativa, AMPC. Esta sigla corresponde en biología al adenosín monofosfato cíclico, pero activar la metamorfosis colaborativa presencial nos lleva a hacer intercambios de diálogos de saberes que nos lleva y nos guía en el flujo para la colaboración radical, en un flujo tanto de información como de recursos que nos van a permitir ese colectivo emergente, ese espacio de formar algo nuevo que se llama biorregión, que se llama estar juntos para hacer algo juntos en donde estemos. Entonces, espero que esta imagen les haya dado un proceso de una imagen biológica de lo que significa la colaboración radical y de lo que estamos haciendo, creando este flujo hacia la emergencia de algo nuevo. Entonces les propongo realmente que participen en todos los eventos que tenemos ahora y los espacios abiertos, especialmente los hangouts o recreos, y que por favor asistamos porque es el llamado, el pulso de poner la atención y de activar nuestra metamorfosis colectiva, colaborativa. Así que ahora sí, Ben, es todo tuyo.
Thank you so much, Melina. And lo siento, I know that was such a beautiful thing. I was excited to have you do it. And then I got carried away with, oh my gosh, we're over time. We got to do things. So I want to bring Claire back in.
Ben, I have a request or a question for you, which I'd like you to answer whilst you're visible. I heard you encourage people or invite people to go and look at the map and so on when I'm singing. And I'm not comfortable with that because this music is very much direct I thou. It's very Buber-esque. But I have an alternative. I just want to put this out there. An alternative is, if you want people to have a chance to look at the map with the sound of my music, we could play the video of me.
No. This is a special hangout. Most of the hangouts, we're going to be playing recorded music. You might.
Okay.
Whatever. Right. So this is different. We're going to honor you. How grateful you're here. The map, you know, that's more of the technological stuff that I think maybe just for today anyway, or for this moment, we're going to let go of it. I'll just open a bunch of rooms. People will find their way. It'll all be fine. So thank you, Claire.
You're so welcome. I appreciate you. All right, I'm going to turn my original sound on, and I'm going to ask someone to check that everyone's muted. Okay. And let's hold a minute afterwards, Ben, so I can stop a little early to make room for that.
Okay. A minute of silence before we go into the breakouts.
Yeah.
Very good. Very good.
So I have to just say something about that. I'm sure most people here are familiar that there are many languages. And Earth speaks in many languages. Silence is part of that language too. But I'm speaking from this silence. So this silence is still active. Everything you do here is going to be important. And Earth is aware. She's saying thank you.
Thank you so much, Claire.
Yeah.
And thank you, everyone. Still with us. And will be with us in different ways for the next 2 weeks and beyond. So I'm going to open up breakout rooms. You won't be assigned to any of them. You'll see an option to join them, and they all have different names. I think it'll be clear which ones are for Hispanoparlantes and which ones are for English. And if you want to stay here, we can talk about the infrastructure of the summit or any other sort of technical questions you have about that in the main room. And I'm going to leave the breakouts open. It officially ends in 35 minutes, this hangout. We're already well into it. But there's no reason to close the room, so stay as long as you like.
Muchas gracias, Ben, por guiarnos. Muchas gracias, Isabel, por sostener también. Y bueno, hasta aquí vamos a tener nuestra traducción simultánea y vamos a entrar en un espacio de conexión entre nosotros. Así que ya sabemos cómo ir a los grupos donde se dice español y vamos a terminar allí. Muchas gracias. Muchas gracias, Andrés, por la traducción.
Breakouts are coming in a minute. Haven't opened them yet. Okay, here we go.